Okay, sorry for the delay and for the I had some technical issues. So it's a pleasure to have this webinar with you today. My name is Peter Reithofer, for those who don't know me. Today we will talk about modeling plastics in LS-DYNA. And if you have any questions, please let me know. We can do it during the presentation, but also at the end. The presentation will be in two parts. And yeah, I hope the next 50 minutes roughly will give you a good, a nice introduction in the modeling of thermoplastics materials, especially on the focus on the isotropic behavior. So as I mentioned already, for the outline, this webinar will be in two parts. In the first part, I will give you a short introduction to our company and services, and then we will focus today on the thermoplastic materials. Next Friday, we will talk about short and long fiber reinforced thermoplastics and composites. And I hope I can then give you in each material class a rough overview about the opportunities and possibilities you have to simulate these material classes with LS-DYNA. So as mentioned, first of all, I would like to give you a rough introduction to our company. The Four Engineering belongs to the Four Technology Group. So as you can see, that's our facility in the middle of the mountains. So we're focusing on plastics and simulations in testing equipment and lightweight products. And if you are not familiar with 4A, perhaps you don't know, we have different business units. So perhaps you know our sister company, Vie Active Systems, which is producing and selling dummies for the testing of active vehicle safety. I'm responsible for the business units from 4A Engineering. We are dealing with the engineering and simulation of plastics, and therefore we do lots of tests and make material cards. Here you see a picture in our lab. So we are offering material characterization as service. So typically, customers are coming to us and sending us raw material, and we can then do the tests. So first of all, we are producing the plugs, and then we're doing conducting tests that can be from dynamic testing, but also creep is possible. We focus here on plastics, foams, and composites. And finally, the material, a validated material card is generated and provided to the end customer that he can use it directly in his simulation. We can do this also for low and high temperatures. And I'm sure you know that we are also offering our products, Impetus, Valimat, Micromec, and FiberMap. So some years ago, we decided to develop these products to be more predictive in the simulation of plastics. On the one side, we have our testing device, the Impetus, which is focusing on efficient dynamic testing. We'll see later on a little bit more on that. On the other side, we're offering software solutions like already mentioned, Valimat, where you can get from test results where you're guided to finally validated material cards. Depending on which material you're using, these products are differently can differently support you. So as you see, for foams and thermoplastics, mainly Impetus and Valimat are good choice to make a material card. If you're going to more fiber-reinforced plastics or composites, we offer additional products like Micromec or FiberMap to take the fiber orientation into account and using micromechanical approaches to calculate the material properties. We can also work with metals, but in case of metals, our impetus device has not enough energy to bring them to failure. So in that case, typically you can use our software product Valimat with external test results to make a material card. All the software solutions can be used together. So we have a token concept which can be used as needed. So that was the rough introduction in our company and our products. I hope it was not too long for you. Is there any question from your side to that? If not, I'm sorry, I don't see the. Okay, thank you. So now we focus on the thermoplastic materials. So first of all, I would like to give you a motivation on the thermoplastic materials, why we would like to make a more detailed material card and what are the issues here in the simulation. Then I would like to talk about material and failure models, and later on I want to go into detail in the material behavior and show you typical results of a Talcum filled polypropylene. And finally I would like to show you some validation results with LS-DYNA on the conducted tests, and I also would like to compare different outcome of material models on the one side on the accuracy, on the other side on the computational effort. So for motivation in the beginning, with the upcoming regulations, that was nearly 15 years ago, more and more plastics had to be simulated. As you remember, in the NCAP, you needed to simulate plastics, and therefore you have to deal with lots of different grades. And so it's always, you don't know what is inside the material, so you have to characterize each material. So on one side you need efficient way to characterize materials. On the other side, if you do this with tensile tests only, you will find out that these tensile tests only are not predictive enough. So in that case, from our customer Audi, he found out all these tests, they were conducted on tensile tests, they had to scale it up to a certain amount to finally get good agreement with the real tests. Reason, we will see later on, is that plastics are often have different material behavior between a tension and compression loading. Nowadays, customers are coming to us and they want to have more and more predictive material models. Here we see a use case also from Audi with an impact on a grill. Here you can see the test curve, the blue one, and we see the old approach with a simplified material card only describing the deformation behavior in average. We see the solid line, which is considering the failure. And customers nowadays want more and more to be more precise, more predictive, especially in the failure approach. And so typically customers are coming to us and requesting, yeah, because they're familiar with it, we want to have material cards for plastics. Typically they request MAT24 because they know it and it's quite fast in the simulation. And they want to couple it with Gizmo because they know that's a quite good quite good failure approach. So now let's have a look what is available on material and failure models in LS-DYNA. So if you have a look, I'm not sure if you know that LSTC have some database where you can look on all available material models. So if you look in it, currently we have 265 material models available in LS-DYNA. And if you search on it, you will find on depending if you're using a shell or solid formulation for plastics, you will find around 30 different models, for shells 23. And yeah, if you look in detail, we will find that most of them are based on a Farmises plasticity or Yod2 plasticity. So Felipe Andrade had a good presentation on MAT24 some week ago. So if you are interested in that, please have a look on this webinar. I think it was 2 weeks ago. For plastics already mentioned, it could be interesting to be have different behavior. And so we're also looking, for instance, for MAT124 and MAT187. So now look in detail on that. So for plastics, as I told you, MAT24 is often used. Here you see lots of derivatives of it. And what do we have? We see that if you look into the behavior, that we have the typical Farmises behavior, that we are constant over the pressure. And so we have constant pressure over different triaxiality states. Farmises model or MAT24 has no viscoelasticity in it, but can prescribe quite well the viscoplasticity. One reason what I dislike on MAT24 especially is that this material class is has a volume constant formulation. So this plastic Poisson ratio is 0.5, which is not what plastic materials behave. If we go to next possible material model, it would be MAT124. I call it the hidden, because not many people know of it. It's just twice MAT24. So in that case, you describe one Farmises model for the tension side, one for the compression side. And a new feature what can be used and which is quite interesting is that you can add a Bruni series here to also describe a viscoelastic behavior, what is quite important also for thermoplastic materials. The next one would be MAT-SAMP. MAT-SAMP, we have different opportunities. I call it the plastic expert. So the yield surface can be freely described over different states. So you have the possibility to make it linear or parabolic or define it piecewise linear for each biaxial tension, uniaxial tension, shear, uniaxial compression, biaxial compression. So you are freely here. What I really like here is also the opportunity that you can define the plastic Poisson ratio dependent on the strain state. And it's also possible to define the viscoelasticity here. So quite lots of opportunities. But currently, no one really uses it because the CPU time is quite high. And we will see later on it. What is upcoming now, there's an efficient version of this MAT187. I would like to show you later on a little bit on it. Here we see then that we have a simplification in the yield surface. It's just linear. And this leads that we are, this is more efficient. But also it's possible to use the viscoelasticity and the plastic Poisson ratio. So it's some kind of simplification of this material model and helps you in the CPU time efficiency. Does anyone has a question meanwhile on that? Okay, if not, then I go further. So on the one side, we were talking about in this material models, we were talking about the deformation behavior of this material class. On the other side, we also want to talk about the failure behavior. And we have different failure models in LS-DYNA. So I like to divide these failure criteria or models in different areas. As you see, we can look on stress-based and strain-based, and we can have different kind of stress and strains. We can look at equivalent principle or on damage formulations. And some of these failure criteria are also included directly in material models. Perhaps you know in MAT 24 you can directly define just the plastic strain, but you can't define this plastic strain dependent on the loading situation. So this equivalent plastic strain will be the same for compression and tension. In MAT SEM 1 you will find something similar to GISMO. And also with this area stress-based, it's possible to define lots of simple failure criteria with just using the mud at erosion and using some limits, like having a limit on a principal stress or principal strain. Keep this in mind, often such simple material failure models are quite interesting because they're working quite good and robust, and you know what you're doing. And then we have the class of the strain damage-based models. So typically you could add this before RA11 as DM and GISMO directly in the matted erosion. Since RA11, there are separated keywords like this mud at damage DM and mud at damage GISMO, which helps you to define different damage models as you like. For those who are familiar also with other solvers, this DM model is more the model, this damage initiation evolution model, which is more common over different simulation solvers. GISMO is something what is typically developed in LS-DYNA and is, from my point of, from my knowledge, only available in LS-DYNA. But what features are necessary for our plastic materials, what opportunities we can use here. For that, I would like to look a little bit more on the difference on the classical DM model and compare it with GISMO, as so many LS-DYNA users are asking for GISMO failure models. So as you know, such damage models are incremental formulations. So what does this mean? During the simulation, we have some development over the equivalent plastic strain. So the stress is developing until we get to a certain limit, critical limit. And then this is the area of the initiation. And at this point, we know damage should start. And then we invoke the stress, the undamaged curve, with different damage approaches. We can damage this curve linear or exponential until the point where we fail, and then we finally delete the element. Here you can see the damage history variable, how it is developing, the initiation, it's summarize the information, how far I'm away from this initiation point. As soon as I reach this initiation point, then I develop further in the damage that could be linear or exponential until I get the failure. That's quite important to know because these limits here, that's the 2D view on it, these limits can be dependent on different variables like the triaxiality or the strain rate. So now compare GISMO a little bit more to DM. So here's a classical design, how we can define the failure strain. So in both cases, in GISMO and DM, we can define the failure strain dependent over the triaxiality. We will talk about this a little bit later. We can define the strain rate, the scaling of the failure strain over the strain rate. So in that case, we see for Draxality 0.3 for uniaxial tension, it is for higher strain rates, it is decreasing. The same situation we can define for biaxial, so the scaling for Gizmo is quite interesting. But we have, as you see, a fixed scale here. And in the case of DM, we are flexible, so we can define different strain rate scale for the Draxality of 0.33 compared to 0.66, and that could lead to different failure description over the strain rate, as you see this in this diagram. So the big advantage of the DM model compared to Gizmo is that we can have a more flexible description in the strain rate scale over the Draxality. On the other side, Gizmo offers you opportunities for element regularization. So if you do such things, here you can see that's a typical failure surface you can get. This is out of a PhD study from Holger Stark from Audi. He did this, and that's the outcome from such a failure surface over Draxality and strain rate. Do you have any question on the models meanwhile?
Hello, I had a question. Do you hear me?
Yes, I hear you. Perfect.
Yeah. A couple of slides ago, you mentioned MAT 24 and MAT, I think, 187 SAMP, and you mentioned the SAMP has significantly more computational time, requires significantly more computational time. Could you give an idea how much computational effort we are talking about? Is it 10%, 50%, 100%?
We will have a special slide on that. This computer will come then next. So, but yeah, it's interesting to look at that.
Okay, thank you.
Any other question from the audience? If not, then I would go into the next step in the more practical side. So now we would look on different test results of a special material. In that case, we look at the talcum filled polypropylene with some rubber in it. So it's impact modified. And clearly, what you're doing if you do research on a material, you can do static tests. In our use case, we did three-point bending tests, tension tests, and puncture tests. And we did this not only with statics, also with the dynamic side. So here you can see the test setups of our testing device Impetus. Here you see the three-point bending test, the tension bending test, which means that the specimen is clamped and goes from a bending to a tension-dominated situation. Then we have a puncture test, and we have the new tension, dynamic tension test. And this is, as it is quite new, I also would like to show you a video how we can conduct this test. I hope it's interesting for you. So you can see now our testing device. And since one year we officially offer this new dynamic tensile testing device. As you know, if you want to make these tests, you need some speckle pattern on these tensile tests. You can see now our fixture. It's a fast fixture that you clamp these samples in it, that it's possible to mount it quite fast in our device, so that it's possible to also make measurements with heated samples. So you can mount these samples within some seconds. Here you see the pendulum arm, which is then later on folding down. And here you can have a first look on our software. Here we choose the setup. We define the velocity. We are now raising up the arm until the height that it stops automatically, which is corresponding to the test velocity. We conduct the test. With a high-speed camera, which automatically records the test and the data is downloaded. And as you see afterwards, we directly start a digital image correlation and evaluate the strain field and generate out of this then test results. So typically we use this kind of template to evaluate it, and as you see, quite interesting, it fails here and here. And in our software, automatically we then get different results. So we have the force displacement and also this finally the stress strain curve. So with that, we can conduct the dynamic tensile tests. On the other side, we also can then measure with the puncture test the behavior of the material. And this is quite interesting. Here I have some failure pictures of different samples. Here you can see a quite brittle failure behavior like at the bomb material. Here you see a ductile failure behavior like we had it in this material class. Or you will see a progressive failure like we have in a fiber reinforced material. So this puncture test gives you information on a BXCR failure behavior. So now we'll look at the test results. So directly we see that the red curves here are the static tests, the blue curves are the dynamic tests, and we directly see that we have a huge strain rate dependency, not only in the whole curve, also in the beginning. So that means that we have a viscoelastic behavior. We also see that if we increasing the strain rate, that will lead us to a more brittle failure behavior. So the failure strain is decreasing if the strain rate is increasing. We see this in that case also for the tensile behavior, but also for the biaxial behavior. So please keep in mind, this looks perhaps differently, and in that case, it could be make more sense that you use, for instance, the DM model. So as you see, what we will see, the material has different behavior on viscoelastic effects. We will see strain rate dependent as viscoplasticity. We have a failure dependent on the triaxiality, and our yield surface is dependent on different behavior of tension and bending test. We will see later on what this will mean, because in the bending test we have a compression and tension behavior in the middle, the average. Do you have any questions until here? Okay, then I go further. So now let's have a look on how we get from the test to the material card. So I would like to introduce to you our software solution Valimat a little bit. And as you know, if you're familiar with simulations, you always think of such kind of pyramids that you stepwise increasing the complexity in your validation models. So we will always start with a simple approach. In our cases, we will do bending tests or tensile tests, static and dynamic, to start with the hardening, with the viscoplasticity. Afterwards, we get this material behavior. Then we will get the material cards. We will focus on the triaxiality, so of the yield function and of the failure. And finally, we should always think about how to validate these material cards we develop on this certain stages on a component to see how is the influence on the element discretization. So here you can have a look on our software. Here's our out-of-it. In that case, I would like to show how this works. So we have mainly a parameterized material card, and this parameterized material cards could be stepwise find the material card. So we have, in that case, MAT24 with a bending case, which will generate this hardening behavior automatically, step by step, first getting the Young's modulus, getting the flow data, and finally getting this strain rate dependency. And as you can see, how does this work? We're using for that LSOpt. So we need take the response surface method. We have our parameterized material card with different variables, and LSOpt is using this method to getting closer and closer to the test curve. The test curve is the dotted line, and the solid line is the averaged this result of the simulation. So we can do this in that case for a MAT24 card based on a bending test. That would be the final validation results. We see quite good agreement for this case, but we can also do this, for instance, for more complex tools. As you see, if you do this approach for MATSAMP, we can do it, for instance, on a tensile test tool, focusing then on yield behavior, going to the failure, and to finally the validation on that. This can all be done with our software Valimat. If you're interested in more in that, we have lots of YouTube videos on our YouTube channel too. So what we are doing on the failure side, that's quite interesting too, especially looking on the plastic materials. So if you think about that, we have different loading situations over the triaxiality, we can offer different test cases on the dynamic side with impetus 2, I already mentioned. We can do the bending test, which will be on that triaxiality. The clamped bending or tension bending test would be on the triaxiality of 0.4. We can do the puncture test, which is around 0.6. And clearly, we could also do the dynamic tension test. In this area, we have lots of tests where we can research the deformation behavior and also the failure behavior. This region here on the shear side, it's quite complicated because currently there's no shear test available which fails under shear loading for plastics. As you see, typically for these ductile materials, it fails not under shear, it will fail by opening it like a tension test. So normally you have no information on that. And in case of the compression test, it will buckle. So you also will not have information on the failure under compression shear. And therefore, we take an assumption in the material card modeling that we say, okay, we can characterize our material in this area between the uniaxial tension and biaxial tension. But in that area, we have to assume the failure behavior. So we say we don't fail under compression, and we have the same failure in shear than in tension. That would be a simple approach, a simple assumption. I got the question. Could you please, one moment, could you tell it please, because I don't see it. It was just short about the bending test.
Hello, I was just asking about the three-point bend test. Would it not have triaxiality around 0.57?
Plane stone? No, it really depends on your bending sample. So the typical bending samples we are using, they are have small width. So we recommend a sample which is like in the ISO, and this has around 0.38 on the tension side. If you make the sample more broad, like in it's known in metal tests often, then you can get in higher triaxiality factors. So it depends how big is the width of your sample. So if you make a if you make a beam or a blade, do you understand what I mean?
Yes. No, thank you. Good explanation.
Okay. Also to mention, be careful if you make tests on the ISO 176, there's a mistake on that point in the ISO standard, which leads you at the 2 millimeter thickness to a wrong width, which should not be used. So We recommend to use samples if you're using samples with 2 millimeter thickness with a width of 10 millimeter and a gauge length of 40 millimeters, for instance. But if you're interested more, you will find lots of information on our website too. Okay, so that would be the assumption for the failure. That's how it looks like in our software. So you can choose then different approaches for the failure. You can choose the add erosion, DM, GISMA model. You can use this piecewise linear. But if you like, you could also use more complex model like a Johnson-Cook or Xu-Wibitzki as a function. And all these parameters are also available for you for the material calibration procedure. If you're doing that, that's the outcome for MatSAMP, so the most complex one. Here you see for this material, we have the hardening curves. We have then the equivalent, we have then the plastic Poisson ratio over the strain. So we have volume constants on the compression side. And you see for this material class, we have roughly a plastic Poisson ratio in the tension side around 0.15. So quite different to MAT24, which is on that level. We can define the yield surface over the triaxiality, and we can define the failure strain dependent on the strain rate. And we have the limit curve and the evolution, how it is it directly deleted, or we have some time for the evolution here. That was the outcome for the most complex curve, and now we're coming back to the comparison. So as you see, this complex card can quite good predict all these tests. So we see that we can describe the bending test, dynamic and static. We have also good agreement for the tension test. We can also describe the tension bending test. We underestimate the failure here. We overestimate the failure here. And also we can describe the biaxial behavior in the puncture test. The failure here is quite good for the dynamic test. For the static test, it could be a little bit improved. So that would be the outcome, what is possible currently with these material models. What we also see not so good is the unloading behavior. So as we don't have invoked the damage model or some specialties in SMAT-SAMP model, the unloading is like the Young's models as we have defined it here. So it is not going like back this, which leads you to an overestimation in the plastic domain. So now coming back to this question, comparison these different material models. So here are some slides. I slowly go through it. The first slide is the MAT24. We're always comparing the dynamic test for bending, tension, and puncture test. So in that case, we fitted this MAT24 on the tension test. And as you see, we are quite good in the tensile test, but we can't predict the bending test because we have this Mises yield behaviors on this uniaxial tension behavior. It's okay, but it doesn't describe it. Also, the puncture test in the beginning is quite good described, but then it overestimates the force response over the displacement. If you go to the SMAT124, please remember we have twice SMAT24. Here we can define tension and compression. As you can see now, we can describe quite good the tensile test and the bending test, but in the puncture test, it's not so good. It's too far away. But also you see, we can't really describe with this MAT24 approach, with this constant, with this Mises approach with constant volume, this development is not quite good here. That's why we are going down. Now we're coming to MatSAMP and MatSAMP Lite. We decided to make MatSAMP and MatSAMP Lite in this example the same. So we only defined the yield curve linear over this drag cellity. In that case, we can quite good describe the bending test, the tensile test, and the puncture test for all these both material models. They were combined with a gizmo model in that case. Now, coming back to the numerical cost, and if you see now the comparison, how good the material model behaves, so you really see MatSAMP is best one because of the yield surface description and the plastic Poisson ratio description in the material model. But as you see, this MatSAMP light also is quite good. We did lots of different simulations over these load cases, bending, clamped bending, tensile test, puncture test, bending tests with different approaches in MAT24 failure, MAT124, MatSAMP, MatSAMP light. And as you see, a summary, compared to a shell modelization on MAT24 with the number one, 2.5 times more CPU time for MatSAMP. And quite interesting is that with MatSAMP Lite, we only have 20% more CPU costs, which means this model is quite promising that we have now a model which can describe this material behavior, but is not too slow. Any question to that? Because before you ask for that. If not, then I want to have some small further slides. So I also would like to talk about element regularization. So this question often is coming from our customers. Yeah, we want to have element regularization, and that is needed because lots of our customers are coming from metal side, and they know, yeah, it's quite a huge impact here. From my point of view, it's also often the reason because you have more influence on this instability point and on the constant volume in the formulation of the material model. But if you have a look on this example, what is the influence on the element size? As you see, it's not a big influence on the element size if I do the tests here for this material class, because we get some stabilization due to the high strain rate dependency and also due to the low plastic Poisson ratio. We will see that the test scatter is huge compared to the influence, often huger than compared to the influence of the mesh size. So that's not always the same, but often we can see this behavior. So element regularization is not always needed. That's what is the message I want to give you here. I also want to mention some upcoming models here. Perhaps you heard about this new keyword MAT add inelasticity. Quite interesting. We also already told about viscoelastic effects. I told you that MAT124 has the opportunity to define a Bruni series. You can fit the Young's modulus over the time or strain rate, and then this will lead that in the static test, you can also describe the static stiffness as it is in the test, the same way as in the dynamic test. So different implementation in MAT124 and MAT180 SAMP, which leads to the same result. But if you don't like these models and you want to take the viscoelasticity in consideration, I really like this approach, MAT add in elasticity, because here you are allowed to add inelastic features like creep or viscoelastic to any material model which is available in LS-Dyna. So now it's also possible to link the viscoelasticity, for instance, to MAT24, which is quite interesting. So now coming to the last point, and it's somehow the outlook for the next week, anisotropic failure, mud at generalized damage. You see plastics in the big question mark. When I was get familiar with this keyword in the LS-DYNA conference in Detroit, I think it was 2 years ago, I was thinking, ooh, why do we need that? Is that necessary for plastics? It took me not too long to see this result. So as you can see here, we have, for instance, ABS. They have the same behavior in the force displacement, but different failure behavior between 0 and 90 degree. And first you think of, we did some mistake on the cutout of the tensile test. But if you compare it, we have quite brittle behavior, failure behavior in 90 degree, and quite ductile failure behavior in 0 degree. And if you make a puncture test, quite interesting, the crack always opens the same direction. So you know this zero orientation out of the injection molding is the weaker direction. This is quite extreme example. Normally it's not so extreme like shown here, but it's quite interesting. So also anisotropic failure could be interesting for this unreinforced thermoplastic material class. So now coming to a summary, I showed you the motivation and a little bit about the general material behavior of thermoplastic materials. I could show you some typical test results for this dark field polypropylene. We discussed about the material models. We showed what observed deformation behavior we can describe with these material models. And we had a focus on the numerical costs. A summary, the new material model, MUTS implied, has only a small increase in the numerical cost, but qualitatively increases the accuracy in the simulation results. So that's quite good. For the failure, we can say currently for plastics, we can only research on the failure and the range from the uniaxial tension to the biaxial tension. GISMO and DM offers you different specialties. Clearly, they can be brought to the same behavior, but the benefit of GISMO can often not be used for plastics materials because they behave differently. And the most advantage for DM is that you are more flexible over the strain rate and triaxiality for the biaxial behavior. And just one hint, take the simplest failure model as possible and as complex as necessary, because this will always lead you to a stable model. And yeah, we're offering you some tools for that you can fit these models in a smooth way and in a smart way. And if you're interested more in that, please join next week's webinar when we focus on the fiber-reinforced materials. Or the other possibility is, I want to mention, you can also come to our summer school, which will be in the middle of July. So if you're interested more in material characterization for plastics and composites, we're offering here 2 weeks trainings over webinar. So it would be a pleasure if I can see the one of you at these webinars too. So thanks for your attention. And if you have any questions, I would be free for that.